الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. And continuing with the virtues and the names of La ilaha illallah, we discussed in the last topic about the conditions of La ilaha illallah, and that one of the names of La ilaha illallah is Qawl al-Thaqila. Heavy word. Another name for La ilaha illallah is, as we mentioned in the ayats that were recited in Salat al-Fajr, is Qawl al-Thabit, is a firm word. A word that when you embrace it, it makes you firm on your two feet. And this ayat was revealed in reference to Adab al-Qabr, the punishment in the grave. As Muslims, we believe in the punishment of the grave. Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he said, أَخْوَفُ مَا أَخَافُ عَلَى نَفْسِي أَوَّلَ لَيْلَ فِي الْقَبْرِ. He said, the thing that I fear most for myself is my first night in the grave. The first night in the grave. The Prophet ﷺ, he mentioned in another dua, to make dua for your brother that is in the grave, فَإِنَّهُ الْآن يُسْأَلُ. Because right now he is being questioned in his grave. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he mentioned as he passed by two graves. مَرَّ النَّبِيُّ sallallahu alaihi wasallam بَيْنَ الْقَبْرَيْنِ فَقَالَ إِنَّهُمَا لَيُعَذَّبَانِ وَلَا يُعَذَّبَانِ فِي كَبِيرٍ. He passed by a grave, two graves, and he said to his companions, the two people in these graves are being punished, but they're not being punished for something major. He said, أَمَّا أَحَدُهُمَا فَكَانَ يَمْشِي بَيْنَ النَّاسِ بِالنَّمِيمَةِ. As for one of them, he used to carry tales between people, separating, disuniting people, creating enmity and animosity between people. Going to this one and saying, guess what such and such said about you. Going to this one and saying, guess what such and such said about you. And to some degree, many of us are guilty of this. Many of us are, you know, whether directly or indirectly, going back to someone and saying, guess what someone said about you. And there's a punishment in the grave for a person who does that. And this person is called a namam. As a matter of fact, the Prophet ﷺ mentioned another hadith, لا يدخل الجنة النمام, that the namam will not enter into paradise. And this is what the scholars call hadith al-wa'id. These are narrations that entail some type of threat or punishment. فَأَمِرُّهَا كَمَا جَاءَ. Then you leave them as they are without trying to interpret them. Because we get into a conflict of, what if the person died on La ilaha illallah? Does that mean if he practices namima, he's not going to paradise? Leave the hadith as it is. Because it's stronger and it has more of an impact on the individual who hears it, as opposed to saying, well, he will eventually enter into paradise, but he's going to go to the hellfire first. Because there's some people who believe that I can deal with a little bit of the hellfire, right? I can deal with a little bit of the hellfire, but eventually I'm going to paradise. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran, وَالنَّارُ أَشَدُّ حَرَّ لَوْ كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. And the fire is hotter if you only knew. If you only knew. So no one, you know, can say like, you know, I can handle a little bit of the hellfire, I'll be okay, so as long as I go to paradise. Leave the hadith as it is. The namam, the person who practices namima, will not enter into paradise. He said, أَمَّا آخَرَ. As for the other individual, فَكَانَ لَا يَسْتَبْرِئُ مِنْ بَوْدِهِ, that he did not clean himself after he used the bathroom. That he used to soak his clothes in his urine because he failed to make what is known in Islam as istinja. Istinja, which is purification with water. Or istijmar, which is the purification with tissue or rocks in the case of the Prophet ﷺ. In our case, something solid, something tangible like tissue, right? To clean yourself. In Islam, this is something that is taken very serious, to the point that the person will be punished in the grave for not keeping himself pure from his urine. The point that I'm making here is that the punishment in the grave is real. The punishment in the grave is real. And the Qawl al-Thabit, La ilaha illallah, is a word that Allah will keep you firm with. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said that when the individual is put into his grave, and his family members walk away from him, walk away from the gravesite, he said that the person in the grave, yasma' qara'a ni'alihim, he can hear their footsteps as they're walking away. all the way up into that very moment. He can hear everything that is going on. And when he is buried, two angels come to him, Munkar and Nakir. Very dark faces, blue eyes, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam described. And while you are alone in that box by yourself, closed in, no one to help you, no money, no gun, no nothing to help you, no family to defend you, nothing, just you by yourself. And this is something that many of us don't do in this life. We very seldom find ourselves by ourselves. We always have someone around us. We always have someone to communicate with. We're always looking for some type of companionship, some suhbah. But there will be none of that in the grave. By yourself. And the angels will come to you and make you sit up. And then they will ask you, Man Rabbuk? Who is your Lord? They will ask you, Wa ma dinuk? And what is your religion? Wa man nabiyuk? And who is your prophet? As for the one who Allah will make firm with the word that is firm, La ilaha illallah, he will say, Rabbi Allah. My Lord is Allah. Have no doubt about that. Dini al-Islam. My religion is al-Islam. Wa nabiyyi Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And he will have no doubt about that. And as a result of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make his grave spacious as far as the eye can see. And a good fragrance will come to him in his grave. His deeds will come to him in his grave, and he will also be shown in his grave his place in paradise. And he will also be shown in his grave his place in the hellfire, had he been from the people of the hellfire. La ilaha illallah. Can you imagine that? You sitting in your grave and you're staring at your place in paradise, knowing that that is where I'm going in paradise. Can you imagine in your grave staring at your place in the hellfire, where you would have been in the hellfire? And that is because the believer always lives his life between fear and hope, even in the grave. Fear that that is the place that I would have gone, and hope that, alhamdulillah, the mercy of Allah, that is where I'm going. Even in our grave, we live between fear and hope, all the way into the grave. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, أَمَّا الْمُنَافِقْ وَالْكَافِرْ. As for the hypocrite and the disbeliever, the angel will ask them the same question, مَنْ رَبُّكْ مَا دِينُكْ وَمَنْ نَبِيُّكْ. They will ask them, who is your Lord? And the hypocrite or the kafir will say, سَمِعْتُ النَّاسَ يَقُولُونَ كَذَا فَقُلْتُهُ. I don't really know. We heard people saying something, so we said what we heard the people saying. Today, you'll find Muslims, you ask them, what does La ilaha illallah mean? What are the conditions of La ilaha illallah? Have absolutely no clue. No clue. They just say what they hear other Muslims saying. I heard the Muslims saying this, so I said what I heard the Muslims saying. Understanding La ilaha illallah, Muhammad Rasulullah, the very shahada that entered you into the fold of Islam, is an individual obligation upon every Muslim to learn what it means. How can you fulfill the conditions of something when you don't know what it is? The first condition of La ilaha illallah is knowledge, al-ilm, to know what it means. The average Muslim, you ask them, what does La ilaha illallah mean? Most people will tell you that there is no God but Allah. And that in itself is an inaccurate translation, because there are gods other than Allah. Allah mentions them in the Quran. أَفَرَأَيْتُمُ اللَّاتَ وَالْعِزَّةَ. Don't you see Lat and Uzza? And Manat, and he mentions the idols, the gods that the Arabs used to worship other than Allah. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, أَفَرَأَيْتَ مَنِ اتَّخَذَ إِلَاهَهُ هَوَىٰ. Don't you see the one who has taken his desires as his God besides Allah? So there are things that people worship other than Allah. So even saying there's no God but Allah is not even an accurate translation. That is not what La ilaha illallah means. La ilaha illallah means La ma'bud bil haq illallah, that there is nothing worshipped in truth but Allah. Meaning anything that you worship other than Allah is false, is a false type of worship. It is not real, because they don't deserve worship. That is what La ilaha illallah means. So, you know, even the translation of La ilaha illallah is not even accurate with many Muslims. So he said that the hypocrite will say, we heard the people saying something, and we said what the people said. But that's not enough. So the angel that asked them the question, Munkar and Nakir, they carry with them a mallet. And they will hit the individual over the head with the mallet, and he will make a scream that will be so excruciating that everything in the heavens and the earth can hear it, with the exception of the mankind and the jinn. And if the Prophet ﷺ said that if the man could hear the screams that the individual makes in the grave, we would fall unconsciousness. We would fall unconscious because of how excruciating it is, how painful to hear. You know, as a parent, most of us are parents, right? You know, you can tell the difference between when your child is plain crying and what we call a hurt cry, right? You can tell the difference. Sometimes a child just cries just to get your attention. And then sometimes a child cries and you can hear the pain in the child's cry. The child may fall, hit his head, her head, and they let out a sound, and then they pause for a minute. And in that pause, as a parent, when you hear that, you stop exactly what you're doing and you rush to that child, because that is a pain, that is a hurtful cry. Most of us are parents, we know that cry, we've heard that cry before. And you would run through fire to get to your child to find out what is wrong with them. That's the natural inclination of the parent towards the child. If we feel like that with a child, with a baby that cries out of hurt, can you only imagine the cry that an individual lets out in the grave when he is hit in the head with that mallet that would make you fall unconscious? SubhanAllah, think about that. And his grave will close in on him to such a degree that his rib cages will overlap or interconnect with one another. And he will be shown his place in the hellfire. This is where you're going. And he will be shown his place that he would have had in paradise. This is where you would have been going. And he will remain like that until Yawm al-Qiyamah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in ending, instructed us to seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala min fitnat al-qabr, from the fitna of the qabr, of the grave. The four things that we should seek refuge from at the end of every salah. And one of those four things is the adab al-qabr, to seek refuge with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the punishment of the grave. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam wa sallallahu ala nabiyyina Muhammad وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما كثيرا وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.